Hey Zane, you know, we're 80s kids, right?
Well, we were 80s kids.
So that means we know a thing or two about 80s and 90s sci-fi.
Absolutely.
So I thought today we would do a 80s or 90s sci-fi talk and list our favorite sci-fi.
You mean like this?
What a really bad sci-fi show.
But it flows. It flows.
I'm talking more like this.
Okay.
So, 80s and 90s sci-fi TV shows?
That sounds good.
Right after this. Welcome to the Whiskey Pop. I'm Zane.
Who am I?
You're Jeff.
Oh yeah, I'm Jeff.
Stop it, Jeffrey.
So today, what are we talking about?
Today, we're going to talk about 80s, 90s sci-fi TV shows.
That's right.
That are amazing or not amazing.
I mean, it seems like in the 80s and 90s, TV sci-fi was way better than even what we have today.
Well, I mean, does it hold up today? Maybe not.
Some of it does.
But the interest, that's some of it there, too.
Yeah. I mean, think about it. People are still cosplaying and buying stuff from those TV shows.
Yeah.
So, I mean, there is something there. But before we talk about that.
Yeah, I would like to at least have some whiskey to go along with this conversation.
And I feel like there's something knocking on heaven's door. Ah! Like what I did there?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah. So today we're going to have, this is a celebrity whiskey.
Oh, no.
Bob Dylan.
Yeah, Bob Dylan. We're having Heaven's Door.
Heaven's Door. But I've been hearing some really crazy, great stuff about this one. And this is the single barrel cask strength. So it's something special. To do this.
I am.
Now let's go in.
Let's do that. Ooh, that smells good.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we're going to go into depth on this, right?
Yeah, on Friday.
Ah, right, on second pour, because that's where we can tell you everything that you need to know about how much of an expert we are.
We're not drinking this already.
Oh my God. What? I can't take you anywhere.
Ooh.
Yeah. Hit us up on Friday. That'll be fun.
For sure. So in the meantime, we're going to talk about 80s, 90s sci-fi TV
sci-fi
shows.
I mean, let's talk about this for a second. I mean, there's a bunch of them that came out. There's some that like really were popular for a while.
And oh, for sure.
As we were discussing, I mean, X-Files was one of those.
Yeah, so number 10 would be X-Files.
Yeah. Sis Mulder on these X-Files.
Spooky Mulder.
I was under the impression that you were sent to spy on me.
As the conspiracy begins to unfold.
Why don't you just admit it, Scully? You're determined not to believe.
And Agent Mulder's obsession with his sister's abduction opens the door to a world beyond imagination.
This won't bring her back.
Yeah, so.
Now, we put X-Files on this list because.
Because we don't watch that show.
We didn't watch that show. But a ton of people did, and it was on the air forever.
Yeah.
And it spurred its own movies.
And a pinball machine. Oh, I got to throw that in there.
You had to throw that in there. You had to throw the pinball in.
I do.
But, you know, to me, X-Files was too much of a cop drama.
Yeah.
And I'm just not into that.
What, again, you know, the idea that you could have those two individual characters, one's a believer.
And one's a skeptic.
And then they can go for so many seasons and not all be believers.
Conspiracy theories, whatever.
So, yeah, we definitely had to discuss it. Because, I mean, seriously.
I mean, X-Files, if you left X-Files
out. It was
out,
a big deal.
Everybody watching me go, what about X-Files? Yeah. Okay, there it is. X-Files out. We got now this next one.
You didn't watch either.
I didn't watch either.
Now,
I know the importance of the show, though.
What this one did was, I think, validate knockoff sci-fi.
Babylon 5.
It was the dawn of the third age of mankind, 10 years after the Earth-Minbari War. The Babylon Project was a dream given form. Its goal,
to prevent another war by creating a place where humans and aliens could work out their differences peacefully. It's a port of call, home away from home for diplomats, hustlers, entrepreneurs, and wanderers. Humans and aliens wrapped in 2,500,000 tons of spinning metal, all alone in the night.
Yeah, now, I watched Babylon 5, I watched a lot of it. It's a social, political, science fiction, man versus the wars and the fighting. Look, we can get into it. Just move on. Yeah, what's our next little?
So this next one, I kind of watched some of these episodes.
Okay.
I've not seen them all, but I mean, this is what happens when you take MacGyver and you put him in a sci-fi.
Oh my gosh.
Or right. Stargate SG-1.
Colonel Jack O'Neill. He says it's important. It has to do with the Stargate.
These people came through, killed four of my people, and kidnapped another using advanced weapons.
Johnny!
Daniel, six hostile aliens came through the Stargate on Earth.
Captain Samantha Carter reporting, sir. Theoretical astrophysicist.
If I don't return, then you must bury the gate again forever. But you'll cooperate.
The Goa'uld have enslaved the galaxy.
I don't care about other worlds.
This had MacGyver in it, a James Spader cosplayer.
Yes.
And Egyptian aliens, a transportation device.
Everything that's quintessential sci-fi.
Yeah, and a TV show.
And now, there are dedicated, like with most cult following type sci-fi. This one, there's dedicated forums and communities that rehash this a lot. So this is a big deal.
And didn't they reboot the show a couple of times? And
well,
had
yeah.
like an SG-1 and then they did another like Stargate Atlantis?
Yes, they did. And then they also were not afraid to pull in characters from other shows, so to speak, and wink, wink at some stuff. And so the writers were good.
Didn't they pull in some characters from a show we haven't talked about yet, but we did kind of
talk about it? Yeah, they did. So
okay, that's right. There was a crossover there, wasn't there?
But they weren't technically those characters, but they were
the same actors. Were the characters, but the same actors, and then they played other characters.
Yeah, and it was great. And, that's the only episode.
Hey, that's the 90s, man. Everything was open to, you can do whatever you want.
Yeah, pretty much. That was the case.
So now, this next one.
This one is cool.
It's cool. It only had one season.
It doesn't hold up worth a crap today for anything.
Not even close.
However, imagine if your favorite commercial, if you even have commercials today, because we stream everything, became a TV show.
And we're talking about Max Headroom.
Where does all this stuff come from, Bryce?
The components of Carter's mind.
Max.
People translated as data.
It's computer generated, whatever it is.
It looks like Edison.
Max Headroom.
Max?
He's a computer-generated person based on you.
Two minds, but with one single memory.
Now, Max Headroom started off as a UK...
It was a bit piece.
Well, it was a UK show where they interviewed celebrities. And then it became this kind of bit piece for commercials and stuff for like Pepsi or Diet Coke or Pepsi.
I think it's Pepsi.
It's this right here.
Hi, Max Headroom here with... This is my guest. I heard you were big time in the old pop biz. Well, I'm going to take that as a no comment. So, nitty-gritty time. What I'm talking about, and you're not, is that more people prefer the new refreshing taste of Coke over Pepsi.
And then they decide, hey, won't we turn this into an actual TV series based on, like, sci-fi?
Yeah, now, the way that this works is it's in a universe where the media controls your life.
Feels like a TV oligarchy.
Where you're not allowed to free think yourself at all. And you can't turn your TVs off. You can turn the volume down, but that's it. They had to stay on.
And it's like, it can read your mind. So it's like, this is every conspiracy theorist's fear.
The reason why it doesn't hold up right now is physically the way that it laid out, like how they did stuff.
I thought you were going to say because journalism is there to save everybody. And we know that ain't true today.
Yeah, that's not true, but where it does hold up is that the conglomerates are controlling your mind. And
yeah, that's true.
Wait a minute, am I being Scully or Smuller?
For all the evidence, why can't you believe?
So this next show, a TV show, I guess if it wasn't on the list, it wouldn't make any sense, but this was a very popular 80s pop culture piece, and that would be, they made t-shirts out of this character, they made a cartoon series out of this character. This character was on everything.
Absolutely everywhere.
He was on Hardy's glasses.
Yeah, he was on Hardy's glasses.
And we're talking about Alf.
Alf.
Spaceship in what, the garage, wasn't that what it was?
Yeah, and then he's forced to live in incognito with this family.
Yeah, this family hiding from the government, always looking for him, or it's always like seemed like government officials coming to the house.
And of course his favorite thing to eat is
cats.
Which of course you would hate, and I don't care.
Yeah, man. Well, I don't eat cats.
That's why. That's exactly right.
Who would want to eat a cat?
I don't know. Alf!
You kill me.
Kidding! I'm a funny alien!
This next show, right? The character has been around since the 1960s.
Yes.
It's a comic book character. This was the first time we actually had the comic book character in live action that I'm aware of. And it was right after the success of the 1989 Batman.
Yeah, The Dark Knight. It's the genesis of the muscular suit.
That's right, and this is The Flash.
This show was great.
I like the new Flash, but this old Flash, I still love it.
Yeah, it was great. It had the strange camp feeling that the Dark Knight show or movie had.
Oh, it was basically was Batman with the Flash.
It was a Marvel universe as opposed to
just like the DCU early version.
Yeah. It's that instead of being like gripped shtick, it was still funny kind of thing, you know, like how we're used to today.
The show also had another famous person, Mark Hamill, the Trickster, right?
The Trickster.
But honestly, I think this is an early version of the Joker.
Yeah, for sure. And that's what I'm talking about. The way this presented was, there were dark elements, but it was very...
campy.
Yeah, it was very campy.
This next show, I've probably seen every episode of this show.
I probably almost have.
And this was 1989 to 1993, but we're talking about Quantum Leap. This
is a doorway we shed one skin and put on another and leap.
Of course it's me. You think I'm going to let you go through this alone? Now look at me.
You're the big city man. You figure it out.
Al, I used to be a doctor. I can't help him die.
I bled him till the snow turned red. He looked like you.
What is wrong with me?
I'm out of here.
This one had a totally different gimmick to the show.
So there's been time travel sci-fis, right? But this was the first time they did a time travel where you traveled into somebody else's body.
Yeah.
So it was like Invasion of the Body Time Travelers.
Not to be confused with the Donald Sutherland
Invasion of the Body Snatchers.
You know, yeah, exactly.
But could you imagine you're time traveling and you appear in the body of a woman, all of a sudden now you have a vagina?
Well, that would be, you know, I don't know. How much time travel would you get done then?
What are you saying?
I'm not saying that. I'm not saying. Yeah. Stop it. But what I am saying was funny about the show.
It was a cool
idea. He would resolve the end of the show. He'd be happy. And then it would, at the last scene of the last part of the show,
he would
be zapped over into some other ridiculous scenario, whether it's in a body of a woman or a criminal or, you know, some hoity-toity dude.
Oh, boy.
Here's one of the best shows ever. Ever made. Which he likes to call Muppets in Space.
I like to call this what happens when you copycat Buck Rogers and just throw a bunch of Muppets in it. You get...
Farscape.
This is madness!
Soft, yes. Weak, no.
I am in charge.
Boy, was Spielberg ever wrong. Close Encounters my ass.
First of all, this is awesome.
First of all, this is Muppets in Space in Buck Rogers.
Now, look. If you're watching Whiskey Pop, it's probably because you like pop culture references. This is a sci-fi show that's what happens because the main guy...
Buck Rogers, no.
Mr. Crichton, stop it. He's an astronaut from the 90s.
So he gets
basically wormholed into space far away from Earth. And so he's constantly making these references to 90s iconic stuff that we all know about. And these aliens have no clue. And so it's just one funny thing after another because he's...
Buck Rogers.
It's not Buck Rogers. It's not Buck. As the budget got bigger farther along throughout the different seasons,
it
got a lot better. It was good.
Now, I know currently you can actually watch the entire series of Farscape on Amazon Prime.
Yeah, it's awesome. Like, it's a you need to watch this show.
So now, our next one actually is a really cool sci-fi. It was our number two. And it would be...
Farscape.
Buck Rogers.
Farscape in the future. It's called Buck Rogers. I'm a little stupid.
This
show.
Is Gil Gerard, and do I need to say her name?
Erin Gray. And cat suits.
Other than Carrie Fisher's Princess Leia.
Oh, she.
I'm going to have to be right up front. I had the hots for Erin Gray.
Yeah, she was that. Everybody did.
She was perfect.
Yeah, the hair, the painted on.
Badass.
Suit. She was awesome.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, absolutely. There's only one reason to watch Buck Rogers.
It was Erin Gray, and then and Twiggy.
Twiggy.
Now it's funny. Twiggy's voice was done by Mel Blanc, was the same guy who did just about every Looney Tunes character known to man.
That's really funny.
And you can hear it if you know that now when you hear his voice. Wow, that's Mel Blanc. Yeah, I mean it's.
What about Buck?
I think what I liked about it was the phantasmic side of the show.
It was like Flash Gordon from the,
one of the old Flash Gordon stuff.
Yeah, and it included a lot of attractive things in the show.
I'll take that as a compliment.
So our number one, you're probably wondering what could possibly be our number one, but what couldn't be our number one?
Yeah.
This had to be it was Star Trek. But
I thought we were going to say Ewoks and Special TV Adventure.
Well, that should be too. But no.
It's everything Star Trek.
Welcome to the Enterprise.
With all new adventures from the 24th century. With an all new Enterprise.
This is nothing like any vessel I've seen before.
And an all new crew. Starfleet veteran Captain Picard. Commander Riker. Executive Officer. Chief Medical Officer Crusher. And her brilliant son, Wesley. Lieutenant Commander Data, an android. The telepathic Troy. Security Officer Yar. Geordi. A man with unique vision. And Klingon officer, Worf.
Shields and deflectors up, sir.
Captain,
alone in an uncharted part of the galaxy, somewhere along this journey, we'll find a way back.
So Star Trek came out with three series in the 90s.
Yeah, they did.
Or 80s and 90s. So yeah. We had Star Trek Next Generation.
Voyager.
We had Voyager. That came after DS9. So we had DS9 and then Voyager.
Yeah, and DS9 is pretty much our favorite, I think, between two of us.
I love DS9. Yeah. DS9 did bring in people from Next Generation.
Sure.
Even permanently. You know, we had Engineer O'Brien.
Yeah.
From the Next Generation. But then later on, Worf showed up.
It's not like we're saying Next Gen wasn't any good.
Next Gen was awesome.
Yeah.
I mean, it's Captain Picard.
Yeah, that's pretty great. He's one of the
better
best
than Kirk.
See, this is why we're your friends, is because we can argue. And however, Sisko
is better than Kirk.
Is better than Picard. I was like, what? There's all of these Trekkie fans out there that know all the ins and outs. And like, wait, you're butchering that in every way. And they're going to be like,
I don't care. Leave I'm a Star Wars fan. Yeah. The Wars, baby!
Oh my gosh, I don't even know what to say about this guy.
So what about you? Did we miss something today?
Yeah.
When it comes to 80s, 90s sci-fi that you think should have been on this list?
Yeah, it's the top, the creme la creme.
Yeah, you can't just throw out some obscure five-episode miniseries and say that's the best.
Yeah,
80s, 90s TV show.
Right, you cannot do this.
So, I mean, but is there something that we didn't bring out today that maybe you think, hey, that should have been on the list?
Yeah.
We want to know. Comment down below.
And in the meantime, be sure to like and subscribe and share this video.
That's
right.
Because
I said so.
Yeah, because you want to.
Yeah, because you want to.
But also, be sure to join in this week with us on Friday when we do...
Second Pour on Heaven's Door. And I think y'all really enjoy it. So, yeah. Be looking for that video to come out.
So, in the meantime...
Be safe and cheers.
Cheers, guys.